And the first person out is the keynote, Kostas Ganias. Just I will say a few words about you, Kostas, before you start. Kostas Ganias is a biologist and received his PhD in 2003 from the Department of Ichthyology and Marine Environment of the University of Thessaly, Greece. Since 2006, he serves as a lecturer in biology, oceanography at the School of Biology at Aristoteles University of Thessaloniki. He has participated in several research projects, and he is currently supervising a number of undergraduate and postgraduate theses. His published work mostly investigates fish spawning dynamics and energetics and improvements of egg production methods for the estimation of spawning stock biomass of fish stocks. The title of his talk is a little bit philosophical, at least the start of it. Determining the indeterminate, a conceptual mechanism for the regulation of the fecundity pattern in marine telost. Welcome.
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank the scientific committee and Olaf Zesbu for providing this information to me for this lecture. So, some of you might be familiar with this picture. This is taken from the album Unknown Pleasures from Joy Division. It's from the beginning of for the early 80s. So the reason why I put this figure is that recently I saw a guy wearing this the t-shirt with this cover art. And in my mind, I thought that this was a series of oocyte size frequency distributions. So actually, it's not for sure oocyte size frequency distributions. It's taken from this 1971 publication. It is. It has to do with astrophysics. It's the first pulsar that has been identified. So the reason I selected this picture is first because I used to be a fan of Joy Division, and second because usually the interpretations that we give to size frequency distributions are closer to astrophysics than reproductive biology. So. This is the schedule of my lecture. I will try to make a brief historic overview on potential allele fecundity. I will present a model for the fecundity regulation in marine teleosts, use some case studies to validate this model, and finally try to relate fecundity patterns to fish biology and ecology. So it seems that for fish reproductive biology, we have two great eras, John Hunter being exactly at the middle. So concerning the evolving concepts on potential annual fecundity and its use in ichthyoplankton methods in the pre-John Hunter era, the idea that fish biomass may estimate it from its ponies quite earlier, first launched by Hansen and Epstein in 1897, in this pioneering paper by Fulton in 1 year later, studying oocyte size frequency distributions in 36 fish stocks, he saw two patterns, one pattern belonging to fish with demersal eggs having a break in their oocyte size frequency distribution and having also narrower spawning periods, whilst the other pattern belongs to pelagic spawners, fish with continuous oocyte size frequency distributions and extended spawning periods. A few years after, Clark, in this, again, very interesting paper, was the first one to put oocyte size frequency distributions in an order of sequential oocyte developmental stages, and it was pioneering this work because, opposite to some concepts to that time, she found that the intermediate batch in the oocyte size frequency distribution is not shed in the proximate year or is not reabsorbed, but it's shed in this current year. So this was one of the first indications of multiple spawning in fish. Again, in a quite famous paper from launched 2 years later from Hickling and Rottenberg, they did a similar work to that of Fulton, studying just four species. But what was new is that they compared two gadoids, or thought to be gadoids, because hake is not now a gadoid, and two clupeids, and saw that Hake displayed a continuous size frequency distribution, so as did Pilchard, whilst Hagdok and Herring displayed a clear gap in their distribution. So probably this paper will remain to history because it was the first time that they introduced the term indefinite to describe continuous frequency distribution, which was probably used later by Hunter for the term indeterminate. And also, similarly to what Fulton did, they related the pattern of oscillatory frequency distribution to the extent of the spawning period. So Cushing, in another classic paper released in 1957, The Number of Pilcharts in the Channel, he was one of the first one to combine fecundity estimates with ichthyoplankton data to provide estimates of fish abundance. In another interesting paper, which was released in 62 by Kazim and Kayum in the Indian Journal of Fish Biology. It's interesting because that period, many interesting periods on fish reproductive biology appeared in that journal. So studying 19 freshwater species, they have grouped three categories of species. In the first group, it was species with a clear gap in the frequency distribution. In the second group, it was a continuous but modal distribution. Whilst in the third group, it was feces with continuous frequency distributions. The first one, according to the authors, displaying very narrow, wider, and continuous spawning periods. So, in 1963, this could be considered as the precursor, as the ancestor of egg production methods released by Saville, which was the first application of the annual egg production method. And now I have here two publications, one from 1974 and one from the beginning of 80s by Mason and Morse, respectively, just to show the concepts of potential annual fecundity just before the pioneering ideas by John Hunter were published. So both papers for both species, for horse mackerel and mackerel, show continuous size frequency distributions. And specifically, the author here tries to face the problem of identifying the potential annual fecundity, thinking that all the oocytes that were going to be shed in the spawning season were in the ovary at that time. And the other paper is even more interesting because it is published in the same journal, the Fishery Bulletin, and at a very close volume to the work by Hunter and Goldberg, having a similar concept for the potential fecundity of a mackerel in the mid-Atlantic bite. So in 1981, for the stock of mackerel, it's a classic application, the application of annual egg production method to that stock. So concerning potential annual fecundity up to the beginning of 80s, the main assumption for multiple spawners was that all eggs to be spawned in a season are yolked at the beginning of the season and spawning ends when these yolked eggs are depleted, according to Hunter and Leung at 1981. Whilst up to that time period, the annual egg production method was the only egg production method available. So what has happened at the beginning of the 80s? First, we have the release of the post-ovulatory follicle method by Hunter and Goldberg. This is really one very important event, because actually based on this publication was the motive for the release of the daily egg production method, again at Fishery Bulletin by Parker. So this paper, which again deals with estimation of spawning frequency, is quite interesting because besides the fact that for the estimation of ululatory rhythm, they use hydrated, the hydrated oocytes method, not the postovulatory follicle methods, but the concept is the same. So it shows the very direct impact of the work of Hunter, which is highly cited inside this paper, to forthcoming papers. So this paper is considered as a cornerstone of reproductive biology because for the first time it was shown that multiple spawner spawns more than 3 or 4 times per spawning season. Actually, Hunter and Leong in the paper on spawning energetics of northern anchovy showed that besides the fact that at any time in the ovary of the anchovy there are just 4 or 3 batches of spawning batches, based on the spawning frequency and the extent of the spawning season, they have estimated a number of about 20 spawning boots per spawning season, which was something completely new in fish reproductive biology. So 1997 was the time of the release of the DPM manual, and inside this this manual we have two of the most highly cited papers by John Hunter, the one dealing with spawning frequency and the other dealing with batch fecundity. And as we can see in this time graph, which shows the evolution in time for the use of the terms determinate and indeterminate fecundity scientific publications, we can see that due to this introduction of these terms are more and more used in the scientific literature. I'm sorry. So, in 1989, again, John Hunter, for shovelfish, for the first time provided the first lines of evidence for how we can determine that a fish has, how we can assess determinate fecundity in fish. Whilst in 1992, again John Hunter in his classic paper on Dover sole, provided the lines of evidence for the accurate estimation of potential fecundity determinate spawners. And two other interesting things that happened during this period was the release of the paper of Nancy Law on the ICES Journal of Marine Science, which introduced the daily fecundity reduction method, and somehow the end of this era, which was the sum of papers released in the Bulletin of Marine Science. It was a special volume on ichthyoplankton methods, which summed all existing methodology on ichthyoplankton methods up to that time. So this graph, which is taken from another publication, actually bases on this publication, on the introductory paper by John Hunter and Nancy Law in this special volume, where they say that whilst procedures in egg or larval production are well standardized and well understood, so to perform a non-planktonic or planktonic ichthyoplanktonic survey, it is quite clear. On the other hand, the fecundity assessment, so the use of either the annual egg production method or the daily egg production method, was still considered as the Achilles heel in ichthyoplankton-based biomass methods. So concerning this was the time period for a new evolving era, which happened in the other side of the Atlantic, namely two main institutes. First, the CIFAS in the UK and the AMR in Norway. So it was a series of papers that tried to introduce some new methodology for the estimation of potential fecundity. So we have this publication from 1987 by Peter Whithames and Greg Walker, introducing a plankton methodology to assess oocyte size frequencies. In the beginning of 90s, in another paper from the same research group, they introduced some stereological methods to assess fecundity, whilst at the beginning of 2000, it was the year that for the publication of the autodiametric method by Andersson and Olaf Zesbu, which is considered now as one of the key methods for assessing potential fecundity. So 1993 is really a milestone because, as I said before, it was the end of the first era of the American era of all this methodology, and the beginning of the new era, and in the middle of this passage lies this great paper by Greg Walker et al. On the fecundity assessment of Atlantic mackerel. So the authors used all the lines of evidence from John Hunter to assess the potential annual fecundity of Atlantic mackerel, but these lines of evidence were quite mixed. So concerning the formation of a gap, they saw that at least at the beginning of the spawning season, there was no gap in the oocyte size frequency distribution. On the other hand, total fecundity declined markedly during the spawning season, and also females that displayed POVs displayed also lower fecundity. And finally, concerning the seasonal evolution of oocyte diameter, if it increased with the spawning season, it didn't show this mark. So they had two evidence for mackerel being indeterminate and two other being a determinate spawner. This was the reason they tried to apply some new types of evidence. The first one dealt with the production of privitellogenic oocytes during the spawning season. So they plotted the percentage of oocytes at the threshold between the privitellogenic and vitellogenic oocytes, and they showed that this percentage declined with the growing oocyte diameter, which is a result which is quite close to the analysis that John Hunter made for Dover Sole. And this is a series of new publications on the application of the autodiametric method. So from a paper by Kurita and Xesbu, they compared the plot of the autodiametric method in determinate and in a, sorry, and yeah, this is a mistake. This is a Japanese flounder and an indeterminate spawner. So the author suggests that there is a state-specific effect for indeterminate spawners for the nature of the graph at lower oocyte sizes, the pattern to be quite different. In another paper released in Fishery Bulletin by several authors, led by Peter Witt-Hames, they applied the autodiametric methods to several species, including both determinate and indeterminate ones, and they saw that the power of the relationship was quite weaker for indeterminate spawners. And this is shown in the residual graphs when only indeterminate spawners were used, but in a proximate paper released 1 year later by Korta et al., when they expanded the oocyte sizes to lower, to include smaller oocytes, the relationship has improved a lot, meaning that this was a very good way to assess the production of privitellogenic, the continuous production of privitellogenic oocytes. Going back to the publication by Greer-Walker, they also used the seasonal pattern of atresia and found that maximum atresia already occurred at the two-thirds of the ongoing spawning season and not at the end of the spawning season, which is the mopping up in indeterminate spawners. And finally, the key, probably the most important line of evidence was the comparison of the period of oocyte growth versus the duration of the spawning season. So according to the authors, vitellogenic oocytes mature over a period of about 140 days, whilst the spawning period was quite smaller. So, putting all these lines of evidence, wrapping all these lines of evidence up, and especially using the last criterion, they suggest that Atlantic mackerel is more a determinate spawner. Sorry. Yeah. Following to this paper, another paper by Peter Wicht-Hems and Greg Walker for the North Atlantic sole, they used exactly the same criteria, the relationship between the duration of oocyte growth and the spawning period, to suggest that sole is a determinate spawner, whilst for other closely related populations of sole, which display much wider spawning periods, this population showed continuous recruitment of oocyte batches during the spawning period, so these were indeterminate spawners. Now I'm going to, based on this concept, mainly based on the last concept, I'm going to describe the conceptual model for the regulation of fecundity in marine teleosts. So for the first case, which is closer to determinancy, oocyte growth is quite larger compared to the duration of the spawning period. So this is time. This is the recruitment and spawning of the first batch, the second batch, the third, the fourth, and the fifth batch. So this can be considered as the batch recruitment period. This can be considered as the spawning period, which equals to the batch recruitment period. And this is oocyte growth, which is larger compared to the spawning period. So we can see that during the spawning period, in this, for this population, there is no recruitment of new spawning batches. On the other hand, for a population where oocyte growth is the period of oocyte growth is smaller compared to the spawning period, we have two batches which are spawned inside the spawning period. So what I did, I tried to make a simulation model and used three populations of multiple spawners, which set it the same number of spawning batches per season, 10 batches. The old population displayed the same in the spawning interval, which was set to 11 days. Each batch consisted of 50 oocytes, which came from, their size came from a normal distribution. Oocyte growth was considered to be linear with time. Okay, this is not correct, but just for reasons of simplicity, oocyte growth was considered to be linear with time. The spawning season was the same for the three populations and equaled to 110 days, which is the interspawning interval multiplied by the number of batches set. And the only difference is was for among these three populations was the time period of oocyte growth. So for the first population, this period was quite larger compared to the spawning season. It was 143 days. For the second population, it was quite closer to the spawning season, whilst for the third population, the oocyte growth period was very smaller compared to the spawning season. So this is the procedure of the module, but for saving some time, I could come back via some question later on. So this is the output of the model. First, for the first population, which seems to be a determinate spawner, because there was no recruitment. This is the oocyte recruitment period, and there was no recruitment of new batches during the spawning period. The total fecundity, which is here, displayed a dome-shaped pattern with time. On the other hand, oocyte size was shown to increase constantly over time. There was no hiatus in the oocyte size frequency distribution at the beginning of the period, whilst hiatus was starting to begin to formulate later on, and there was a clear growing hiatus during the period of spawning. On the other hand, concerning the second population, there was recruitment of oocyte batches. Here is the oocyte recruitment period during the spawning period. The total fecundity displayed a dome-shaped pattern over time, and there was the hiatus was only formulated during the end of the spawning period, and this is for the indeterminate spawner. We can see here clearly a model oocyte size frequency distribution. Total fecundity and oocyte size were all mostly constant over time. So this is the comparison of all three types of spawners. This is the determinate, this is the intermediate, and this is the indeterminate spawner. Clearly, here it is, as according to Xesbu, the stabilization phase, meaning that fecundity is constant, but we don't see any spawning activity inside this phase. On the other hand, even fecundity is constant over time in the other two populations, there is spawning activity, and this is why total fecundity is quite lower compared to the determinate population. Another interesting result deals with the timing of the spawning period, which is the same, but there is a shift from the determinate to the indeterminate spawner. And concerning oocyte size, it grows in a quite different way. So I have to be a bit quick. So this is the validation of the autodiametric method. So concerning case studies, first starting with sardine, which is my species of interest, which is considered a classical case of indeterminate spawner. This is the seasonality of spawning. So using a multinomial model for pre-spawners and spawners and the prevalence of spawners over time, I calculated the dates of the beginning and the end of the spawning period, which was 143 days, with using time lags analysis, the oocyte growth period was only 45 days, which is quite smaller compared to the spawning period. Which satisfies the fact that oocyte exhibits indeterminate fecundity. So using information from the interspawning interval and the oocyte growth period, I have calculated that at any time it's predicted that four batches should be present in sardine ovaries, which was verified both by histology and by processing of whole mounds. Here is, are several evidence comparing determinate and indeterminate spawners, the seasonal evolution of oocyte size frequency distribution. So for determinate spawners, there is no hiatus at the beginning, but there is a growing hiatus at the duration of the spawning period, whilst for two hec populations we have no hiatus. Another comparison comes from the paper of Xesbu from 1990, where there is, I found through the simulation model the same pattern of decrease in the standard deviation of the frequency distribution for the determinate spawner, the same dome-shaped pattern of total fecundity over time from several publications. Also, a dome-shaped pattern of for the evolution, for the relationship between total fecundity and oocyte size. This corroborates with recently published public information. This is also output of the model, which agrees with this evidence from Olaf's paper that oocyte size can be used to estimate the time from the period of spawning. So summing things up and going to more to biology, this is how to say the basic assumptions that biological assumptions that are made for determinate and indeterminate spawners. So concerning that distribution, the terminate are considered to be boreal species having total spawning, being total spawners, having limited periods, being winter spawners and capital breeders, whilst indeterminate spawners are considered to be more tropical and temperate species, having multiple extended summer spawning periods and being income breeders. So I think that I have to jump somewhere from it. Has my time expired?
Yeah, I think it's a red card.
So I don't know. Am I allowed to have a couple of minutes? Or?
Then there will be very few questions.
Okay, to sum things up, by comparing the oocyte growth rates here in this table between determinate and indeterminate spawners, it seems that in general, determinate spawners exhibit much slower oocyte growth rates, whilst there is a latitudinal pattern on the duration of the spawning period. So using these two lines of evidence, it can be shown that determinate spawners are predicted to be boreal species, whilst the temperate and tropical species are predicted to be more indeterminate spawners. Okay. Thank you.